everybody. I love to be a little bit fashionably late, so thanks for waiting. Yeah. So before I start with you, I'll introduce myself. My name is Luki from Chenbei Staking. So I actually lead the staking sector of Chenbei, but we also are decentralizing our data layer. But that's enough about me. Let's start with Rob and just tell everyone what you do and a little bit about your project.
Okay, hi everyone. Yeah, thanks for making it through the wind and the rain and the roads today. Appreciate you coming here. And appreciate you guys having me on Epic Web 3 today. I'm from Alchemy Pay, which is a fiat crypto payment provider. So on and off ramp provider, fiat to crypto. We also do crypto funded MasterCard, Visa cards, virtual and physical, which are awesome for building brands. That's kind of one of the solutions I'm most excited about right now. And I think we're seeing a lot of progress in the space. So that's something I'm currently focused on as well. So really anything for web developers, Web3 developers, we've got a lot of sort of payment services, widgets, checkouts, API integrations that we can do for you guys. And yeah, looking forward to chatting about restaking today.
Hey, I'm John, co-founder of Hyperlane. Hyperlane is an open framework for interoperability. Tell you more about it today in different occasions. But what we do is we let anyone connect any chain with this open framework, do it on their terms, maintain their sovereignty. And really the way we think about it is now you're being exposed to this kind of the instantiation of Ethereum's roll-up roadmap. And there's many people working on creating tools that make it easier and easier and easier to launch your own chain, launch your own roll-up. And with that, you need a way that scales to connect all of them. And that's exactly what Hyperlane is.
Nice. My name's Rock. I'm a co-founder at EtherFi. EtherFi is a liquid restaking protocol based on Ethereum. So when you, if you go to EtherFi, you can put your ETH in, you get back EETH. When you get EETH, you get staking rewards, high layer points, soon to be restaking rewards. EtherFi points, and then you maintain composability to go into DeFi. So a variety of different integrations, Aave, Bendel, kind of across the board. So we're currently in season two of our points farming. So if you haven't done so yet, season two airdrop duration goes until June 30th. So put your ETH in now and get an airdrop. So anyway, look forward to talking more today.
Beautiful, beautiful. Well, we have all three legends over here, but before we dive into the risk and security piece of restaking, I would like to ask our panelists, just for the audience who doesn't really know much about restaking, try to explain restaking to a five-year-old so that all of us understand.
All right, so if you're five, I'm basically five, three-year-old, so I explain a lot of things to her, like she's five. You have a toy. It's a really cool toy. It lets you do amazing things. You're very happy with it. But other people want your toy as well.
And so normally,
you have to give them your toy. And it's kind of like a one person per toy experience. Some toys can be shared. Our toy in this case is the security provided by Ethereum. And we like to think that it would be easier instead of just one person using it as a dime. If we devise a clever enough mechanism, this is the one enabled by Eigenlayer, but also in large part by folks like EtherFi, now we basically are, you know, create a sort of sharing of this toy so that you and I can play with it at the same time. We're not getting the same exact experience as when we were playing with it one at a time, but now multiple people can get exposed to this, play with this toy at the same time. Get a similar enough benefit to it as we were in the experience when we were doing it kind of one-on-one.
That was really good. I'm gonna go, and you're 15 years old now. So I think one of the things that frustrates me about crypto is the words and the nomenclature we use. Sometimes they're just very confusing. So I try to put things in TradFi terms just because people start to understand that. So this isn't one-to-one, but it kind of, we'll get there, so just go with me. So if you think about it, like Ethereum, the actual blockchain is, we'll call that like a central bank. If you put money in there, you know, a traditional central bank, they'll give you money back. And so for putting your cash in, you get it back. Same thing with Ethereum. You put your ETH in there, you stake it, and you'll get rewards back for that. The next level of that is restaking. And so that's specific ABSs or protocols can build on that block space. Think about it as a corporate bond. So Google goes out and says, hey, we need $10 million for something, and we'll pay X percent over some amount of months. Very similar thing for restaking. And so, I think it's important to kind of understand like what you're doing. And so restaking allows these protocols to get up and going quicker with this block space that you can have out there. So it's super exciting time because restaking is now just becoming a reality. Eigenlayer's spent a ton of time building. They just went to mainnet last Monday. And so we'll now see restaking instead of just like points farming. So it's actually a super, super exciting time.
Well, just so you know, you need to be a really smart 5-year-old to understand.
No, I went to 15. I went to 15.
You didn't go to 5.
You didn't go to
15. I said there's a clever 15-year-old, yeah. Ethereum studious, going to high school, getting the grades, trying to get to college.
Cool. Okay. So Rob, before I start with you, I just would like to introduce Henry to everybody. Henry is from Picasso, and we just did a round of introduction. Would you like to introduce yourself to everyone?
Yes, yeah, sorry about that. I was in traffic with water here at this level, so.
Yeah, we all took boats here.
Yeah, I was on the stand-up paddle board on my way here, so. Yesterday we launched our restaking hub on Picasso Solana Hacker House. We also launched our first ABS on our restaking hub, the Solana IBC. We're a interoperability hub and a restaking hub between Cosmos and Solana. And about 2 weeks ago, we launched the Ethereum IBC. Within this week, you should be able to go from Ethereum converting any ERC-20 assets into ICS-20 assets in Cosmos, and then to SPL assets on Solana. So all assets across all these ecosystems should be multi-chain from here on. And I don't think people on Twitter really understand what that means until it becomes reality when you see an Ethereum asset sets into your Phantom or your Soulflare wallet, which will be the reality soon.
Very cool, very cool. Well, thanks for joining us. And our first question actually was explaining restaking to a 5-year-old. So, we actually did 15-year-old and 5-year-old. So you pick the age you want to explain restaking to.
I'll try the 5-year-old. Yeah, I think restaking is a very simple concept, actually. It's a marketplace. So it's a security marketplace. On one side, someone offers something, and the other side, someone wants that thing, pays for it, right? And what they offer on one side is security, ability to make sure something's safe, something is doing accordingly, in agreement, and the other side is the people that need something secured. So the perfect example that I usually give to an investor or anyone that wants to understand me staking is good. You have to first understand staking. Right? Staking just means that, look, give me your phone.
Well, I have my notes.
Okay, sorry. So I have a phone, right? And I'm asking her to hold on to my wallet, right? So someone's gonna hold on to my wallet, and she's gonna hold on to my wallet, I have her phone. So if she wants her phone back, she needs to protect my wallet. That's staking, right? And then, next thing you know, you give that wallet that I just give you to secure, and I give that phone to a liquid staking provider, right? Yeah.
Getting further away.
Yeah, and then Rob's going to give her something. Right, so basically, her job is to keep my wallet safe and keep on earning things, right? And then as long as my wallet's safe, her phone's safe, and she can always get her phone back, right? So I don't know, you can explain that to a 5-year-old with candy, or you can explain to a 5-year-old with ice cream, however you want to explain it, that's just it. It's, someone needs something to be secure and wants to pay for it.
and that's why I'm speaking, yes. So I don't know if I did it right or not, but hopefully that's helpful.
Interesting.
And you got
your phone back.
And
you're
she got
her phone back.
No security.
Yeah.
No security.
No, that's the whole point, right? I have to get my wallet back.
All right. Our last, Rob, how would you explain restaking to 5-year-old?
I'm happy with the explanation so far on this one, if that's okay. Yeah.
Okay, sounds good. Let's move to the next question is, tell everyone what really excites you of your project. What do you think your project, what feature is groundbreaking? What feature is the feature that you want to tell everyone about?
Okay. I think people don't understand the IBC stack, or within Cosmos, enough, and how it relies on the consensus of the transferring the receiving chain without any middleman. So once people understand truly why that's important, and they can start to understand that you can not only send assets back and forth, you can send messages back and forth, and you can do restaking across all the networks that are connected through IBC. So obviously we're starting with Solana and the Solana IBC, and we can easily go to Ethereum, we can easily go to Polkadot, and we can actually go across all the Cosmos chains. So there's some, besides AgenLayer, I think there's a new network that came out a few weeks ago called Korok. I believe it is from this region, and they mentioned they wanted to be staking everywhere. For us, we're using the IBC as an infrastructure to do restaking everywhere and bringing that to different communities, different networks that have communities and that have liquidity to support for the assets. So I'm not sure how they're going to do it or others are going to do it. As far as I know, the IBC stack as an infrastructure is probably the most reliable way to do things permanently or sustainably without any permission of any middleman to do that for restaking or interoperability. So that's what we're working on.
Okay, so AlchemyPay, we're one step removed from restaking. Really what we're doing is allowing retail users, institutional users to move their funds between fiat and crypto in a really seamless way. So anyone who's wanting to use these protocols, wanting to easily get hold of the correct tokens, can do so through AlchemyPay. I think at the moment, the thing I'm most excited about, as I mentioned earlier, was the idea of the crypto-funded MasterCard and Visa cards, which are branded white label for various projects. So for us, we're really interested in the idea of bridging the TradFi world with the crypto world, or at least allowing people to be able to access the Web3 world, the crypto world, and allow them to access these kind of restaking protocols. So this is really kind of, I think the MasterCard and Visa cards are what I'm most excited about.
For me, it touches on what I was mentioned in my introduction, but with Hyperlane being an open framework, allows anyone to connect any chain they'd like, and once their chain has Hyperlane, can very easily connect to other chains in a manner not dissimilar from how IBC works. We like to think of Hyperlane as kind of a spiritual successor to it, and some of the people who designed IBC came to fix their original mistakes with their work on Hyperlane. More specifically, we just launched a new feature a couple weeks ago, which if you'll be here sometime in the next hour, I'll be giving a talk about, that we call Yield Routes. Everyone here is probably familiar with what Blast did, with what Manta did, insofar as enabling what they called native yield into their rollups, where depositors were getting yield on their bridge assets. Well, with Hyperlane and with Yield Routes, we just made this feature accessible to everyone. So anyone who uses Hyperlane is now able to provide native yield bridges going into their chain. I think the first one's going to go live in the next week or two, which we're very excited about. It's been really cool to see all the demand for it.
Cool. I think the thing that I'm most excited about, so restaking is actually the first product that we launched. We just launched another product called EtherFi Liquid. EtherFi Liquid allows you to deploy and to manage DeFi strategies with two clicks of a button. So just think about our thought is to be, if you want to be long ETH and you want to earn passive yield or rewards, we want to be the easy button for that. So there's a lot of people in DeFi who love, you know, running all these strategies, but most people won't take the time to do it. So with us, with EETH, we have EtherFi Stake. EtherFi Liquid is like your investment account, and it goes into these strategies. So there's like five strategies it goes into: Balancer, Uniswap, Pendle, like a variety of other ones. We're coming out with market neutral product too. That'll have like some basic market neutral strategies in it. There's gonna be some Athena in it. So anyway, that's super exciting. And the next product we're building is called EtherFi Cash. And so we're building like a financial services platform. So like if you hold ETH and want to be able to like pay, so similar to what they're doing at Optimal Pay, like being able to use a credit card and paying like for real things with it. So we're super excited about kind of what's going on, and it's kind of aside from restaking. Restaking is one of the things, but I'm super excited just on the restaking front for these ADSs to start to come online, because it's been a lot of work in progress.
Love to hear all those cool features. So, okay, so those are the things that excite us, and those are the really good technologies and innovations you guys have. But what keep you up at night? What keep you up, like, what's your worst nightmare of what you're building right now? Like, what's the thing that everyone should be concerned about, or you're concerned about?
I think security is my biggest concern, so, just kind of across the board, I think that's like with crypto, the thing that scares me the most, just some of the hacks that happen and whatnot. We take every precaution possible to make sure, you know, we do bug bounties, we've been audited 8 times. But as you start to get involved with more protocols, there's just more risk that gets involved. Eigenlayer smart contracts are very well audited. They're not that complex. So that's good. I feel pretty good there. The ABSs starts to concern me a bit, like if a slashing event happens. So ultimately security of funds is what keeps me up at night, because we see ourselves as like a steward of capital first and foremost. And so we gotta make sure we're protecting our users' funds while helping them earn rewards.
Very similar concerns in that regard. Very true, the Aguilar contracts are very well audited and been built by some of the best people in crypto. Still very new, so that is also scary. But luckily, no slashing anytime soon, so we're good there. For us, with Hyperlink, the scariest thing is, you know, you build an open framework, you let anyone use it. You know, if someone here, while we're talking, like, just went and deployed Hyperlink on another chain and you started using it, we don't know. It's not going to get a notification that says, hey, this person deployed this, right? There's no mechanism for that. And so some people could either deploy what we've created and not do it correctly, and or maybe even like maliciously do it, and people will still probably associate that with Hyperlink, right? And so that is always a concern, and it comes with the territory. If you want to build a tool that really is permissionless, like you gotta, you know, you get all the bad with that good. You either gatekeep and then try to do your best to curate away bad actors, or you say, fuck it, everyone's gonna be able to use it. And that opens the door for not great people sometimes to do not great things. And that's kind of the reality of working in this industry.
Yeah, I don't think you want this to turn into sort of, you know, the errors of 2008, you know, the financial crisis, the idea of rehypothecation. I do think Eigenlayer, you know, seems fantastic, seems very solid. I think that's about 8% of staked ETH right now as well. I think there are too many eyes on it, but you know, we don't want to say, oh, too big to fail or anything like that. I think we have to be very careful. Vitalik actually has spoken before about the idea of a systemic risk, but I think that was, you know, a couple of years ago he was talking about that, and I think a lot of people took note at that point, and I think a lot of people have been very carefully, you know, assessing the risks involved in this, because it is something where, you know, clearly you have to do due diligence, which people working in crypto, you know, probably could do with doing that just in general more anyway, you know. But I think it's a really exciting development, and I think at the moment things are going well, so it's okay. From our perspective, you know, we're really interested in what we're able to do in terms of moving funds between fiat and crypto. So from our perspective, in terms of security, it's a whole different ballgame. You know, we're working on having the licenses, various payment licenses around the world. We've just gained a couple more in the USA, state licenses, application in UK at the moment as well, just about to go through with the API license. So, you know, we're focusing on something else, and also we're not custodying assets in general. So we're kind of at a slightly different angle, but I think the idea of LSTs is exciting and a little bit scary too.
For our side, we're relying on the consensus of the two chains, and the smart contract risk is probably the biggest risk. So we have auditors, we'll be publishing a lot of the reports from here. And the other side is we're working the Solana ecosystem, so working with the team and the congestion with the network, the upgrades, and all these things are I don't know if that would keep me awake at night, but it's definitely the things that we have to solve. Other than that, I think making sure that our solution is comparable or competitive to other centralized solutions that is permissioned in the middle, typically are cheaper, but I think in our case, we can actually come in very competitive, if not faster and cheaper than many of these other solutions from Ethereum to Solana, as an example, and even to Cosmos Dance to Solana. So making sure that we are not only the most permissionless and most secure solution to go between the chains, and people actually understand and use it, is probably what's keeping the network up and down.
So now, to make everyone feel a little better, those are the things that scare you, and also same, and those are the things that scare us as well. So tell us a little bit more about the risk management framework you guys have in place. Rob already mentioned some auditings and also like regulations. Rob mentioned about regulations and stuff like that, have the licensing. So tell us a little bit more of internally what kind of a risk management that you guys have in place so that we as users, we as consumers feel, okay, you know, we want to give it a shot, we want to give it a try, even though we're playing with money.
One of the things that's going to become very prevalent is restatement rewards come from the ABSs that build on top of you, and they say, hey, we'll pay X for it. There's a couple different ways that people are kind of approaching this. We are curating that list of ABSs, so we're focusing on what we think are like the top 8 to 10 ABSs that we feel super good about, that they're building something good, you know, feels the team solid. We do like deep due diligence on that. And then we're working with Gauntlet to do like put together a risk framework, because basically with restaking, you point these withdrawal addresses and you can actually put different ABSs on top of each other. And so there'll be multiple ABSs on these. So we need to have the correct like calculus, I guess, of make sure we're mitigating risk while maximizing rewards. But as I mentioned earlier, we're going to make sure that we are like protecting people's capital first and foremost over maximizing rewards. In crypto, we love rewards, and people will ape in when they see whatever percent APY. And so there's other liquid restaking protocols that are going that route and just going to take the high APYs, and they know a slashing incident will come, but they think that it's just going to be made up by taking you know, those higher APYs over time. So we are on the other side of that. We just, with all our power, want to avoid a slashing incident, because we think it could be pretty like catastrophic to the protocol. So I guess the TLDR is we're working with Gauntlet and a variety of other providers for ABS selection, which I think is like one of the most important things for actual restaking rewards that'll come up over the next couple months.
So for us, it really starts with the best practices that you use in-house as you develop the software, because crypto's different. You know, last 10, 15 years of tech have been a lot about, you know, move fast and break things. But crypto is very different. You know, if you make a really, really big mistake when you work in somewhere like Facebook or Google or whatever, like, what's the worst that's going to happen? You know, Instagram doesn't work. Fucking YouTube video doesn't load. The like button's not as good, or like my one-click checkout button on Amazon doesn't work as well as it used to. You could make a much smaller mistake in crypto, and someone's out all their money. Your protocol's out 9 figures, right? So crypto, from an engineering perspective, needs to be treated a lot more like aerospace and not like, you know, the more recent examples of software development, right? It's, you make a small mistake, the plane falls out of the sky, right? So when we build things, you do take a slightly slower approach. It doesn't mean that you know, develop an apathy or you stop shipping, but multiple reviewers, no one on your team is too good to be reviewed. Everything goes through multiple rounds of review. Then what can you do outside of your team? So you can rely on things like auditors. You can rely on things like active bug bounties, right? So with Hyperlane, we have some of the largest bug bounties on Unify. But at the end of the day, these systems have to get tested in the wild. So far, Hyperlane's been in the wild for, you know, give or take a year. No incidents yet, knock on wood. But that's really, when it comes to risk management, it's best practices in-house, and that starts with like really good OPSEC for everyone, really strong review principles, hiring people that are security-minded, and again, think of this a little bit more like aerospace engineering that they do of moving fast and breaking things, and you rely on external things like audits, bug bounties, and you just have to engage with crypto in this way.
Yeah, happy to. For us, we have for the new connections such as Ethereum IBC and Solana IBC, we'll have rate limits initially as we test in the wild. So, although they're audited, they're open source. Ethereum will open source shortly, and Solana IBC has been open source since the beginning. We'll aggressively test that in open market with rate limits. We don't foresee anything going wrong, but that's just a precaution that we have. On the ABS side, we've been in discussion with a number of projects that want to rely on the security of Solana and SOL holders. We're actively validating what they're doing and making sure that it's open source, making sure that these are use cases that actually reward the restakers. We come from an approach of taking a piece of the fees that go in and out of Solana IBC. About 40% of those bridging fees actually go to the restakers, and those are real yield, so we're providing real value. So some ABS, if they're rewarding just inflationary tokens or emissions, we have a lot of questions to ask about what are these tokens for. So we hope that more projects are becoming ABS, start thinking about revenue and not just inflation and tokens.
Rob, would you like to?
In terms of our compliance team, we're really focused on making sure that we comply with the regulations of various different countries. It's quite different from DeFi, where you've got more self-regulation going on at this stage. For us, it's a bit more black and white in terms of what we are allowed to do, what we're not allowed to do, the kind of geographical areas we can cover, the kind of users we could work with as well. For us, although the regulatory space is constantly shifting, constantly changing, in some ways it's perhaps more clear cut than for those working in restaking and DeFi.
Okay. So, Rob, let's go on just a kind of individual questions so we can start from Rob and understand a little bit more about Ethify. Now we talked about the risk management, we talked about your worst nightmare. So, okay, let's talk about for Ethify. We have a lot of interest on Twitter, online, offline, everyone's talking about Ethify. So, now you're talking about all those risk management and users' token, users' assets are the most important things. How do you manage risk, like the emergency response? How do you manage incident response when there's like security breaches and stuff like that? is there a team that can, they're on site or like on call to manage those kind of incidents?
Yes, so our dev team has a system of like on-call systems, and we're basically able to like shut contracts off if something bad were to happen. The nice thing with staking, the majority of our assets are in the Beacon Chain. So like for a bad hack to happen for us, you know, like the Ethereum Beacon Chain would have to get hacked. So we do keep about 1 to 5% of our assets in the liquidity pool so people can move in and out easily. But you know, if someone were to drain that, we'd block that and then, you know, disable withdrawals. So, you know, it's not catastrophic if that were to happen. I mean, it's still not great, but it's not catastrophic. So we go through all those things and make sure that we're kind of, you know, setting ourselves up in the best way possible. I think one of the responsibilities, you know, we have in crypto is a team building. You know, for better or for worse, crypto has damaged the trust of users over time with a variety of different, you know, rugs, scams, whatever you want to call them. And so I think that's one of the most important things that we do is that we build trust with our users. Our team is like, it's why our team is fully doxed. We're like very open about our security, what we're trying to do. And if we make a mistake, you know, we're open about that and try to course correct quickly. Because I think our goal is not just to get a quick outcome on EtherFi. We actually think that DeFi can change how people interact on a day-to-day basis and transact. And that's kind of the vision of EtherFi Cash, EtherFi Stake, EtherFi Liquid. So it's really bigger than just the staking stuff, and the protocol's done super well, and the token's trading well. Those things are all good, but it'll be a failure ultimately if we don't have like a bigger impact on how people transact on a day-to-day basis. So that's really our mission and what we're trying to do and accomplish. And hopefully like we can help onboard the next 100 million, 10 million, whatever it is, users into crypto.
Yeah, one thing I do want to mention is when I was learning about EtherFi, I was actually reading through all your audits too. So it's actually very, very comprehensive auditing that you guys have done. So just want to mention that if you guys have any questions or want to know more about the security or the auditing side of it, they do have good documentations for that. My second question to Hyperlane. So with all those tailoring customization of a security layers or the customization, what kind of configuration do you see that's most common for devs?
So this is funny, right? Because you can do all these things. You can make it as complex. Take a step back. With Hyperlink, anything that provides a state attestation, so think is like Chainlink provides attestations about its Oracle feeds. Any validator system provides attestations as to what happened, and that's what you're getting out of the validator system. Anything providing a state attestation or anything providing a state proof, so think of like some nifty ZK magic that says, hey, this is what happened, and here's the ZK proof for it. Any one of those two forms, state attestation or state proof, anything of that sort can be turned into a Hyperlane security module. So really what they are is they're like these somewhat thin wrappers on top of another state assurance mechanism. And so with that, you'd think people would really like go out of their way to do like crazy wild things, but and what we've seen so far, and this is probably because like the target audience for Hyperlane today are people who are deploying new chains and rollups. And the thing they are most interested in is speed and getting to market. They don't want to, you know, build for 3-4 years and only then launch. They don't want to fake that model. They want to hit the market as soon as they can. And because of that, many of them are opting for more simple security configurations where they're basically going with a small validator committee, oftentimes involving the team itself, if they're using a roll-up provider, if they have any investors or other folks in their community. So basically, validator committees of between 5 and 10. And that's the most used by far. I think, again, just because speed is of the essence. And I think a lot of them, because they know that they'll be able to shift from an existing module to a more sophisticated one, or also just add the more sophisticated ones as the stakes grow for them, meaning like, hey, you know, we were that crypto equivalent of like, you know, two people in a garage, and now we became like a bigger company. The stakes are higher, we now need to get our act together. So I guess that's why in practice we end up seeing not super sophisticated security compositions.
So since we're running short on time, my last question to our panelist from Picasso is that to manage the security between Solana and Ethereum, so you are actually you're introducing or staking to Solana. So with that being said, so you have two chains, market chains you're working on. How do you manage the risk? How do you manage the security?
So on the Ethereum side, we're taking the proof, ZK proof, and verifying on the light client. And so it's everything we're doing on basically the IBC standards that is activated across all the Cosmos chains. There hasn't been any really anything in the IBC stack from hacking or any issues since 2021 that is affecting the interoperability across all the Cosmos chains. So, you know, we expect the same between Ethereum and Cosmos. On the Solana side, we basically have to create a state proof on the Solana network using basically a guest blockchain architecture, and that is being secured by the restaking layer. So everything we're doing is basically relying on the transferring and receiving chains itself. And between that is just relayers. So you know, I personally don't want to take on that risk of basically permissioning what goes through, what doesn't, and giving that permission. We're relying on the chains to do that. And these connections are, once they're live, and you know, you can't shut them down. No one can really interrupt them. It just goes. So, you know, that's kind of the permanent solution of interoperability that we see Cosmos ecosystem have built over the years. And we want to extend that to Ethereum and Solana. So yeah, from our perspective, it's that's the best solutions we can find in interoperability long-term.
Thank you so much. So before we end the whole panel, I would like to ask every single panelist here, is that with everything you're building right now, what innovation or what technology you would like to have? Like, you want to see it in the future you want to implement, you want to work on it, but you don't have it yet.
Well, something that we're working on is the idea of not just giving the ability for people to exchange between fiat currency and cryptocurrency, but also adding the idea of multi-currency exchange between fiat currencies as well. Really a real one-stop shop for all kinds of currency exchange. And that's really dependent on licenses, what's possible. But I think for the user, you know, and for crypto in general, it will give, you know, the whole process will become so much more seamless. Everything can take place in one place, on one app or one checkout page, you know, the choice between various different currencies. And I think also give more legitimacy to crypto as well, to tokens as well, putting them in the same bracket as regular fiat currencies also. So, I mean, that's something that I'm excited about, we're excited about, and we're working towards as well.
Thank you.
For us, it can perform multiple actions on IBC at once. So, you know, if you can take that into account and think about this interoperability, is you can literally do things on Cosmos Hub and Osmosis, you know, without first bridging over. Basically, you can perform action wherever you are on other networks. So in the future, what we're building is basically a router that you can perform actions on Ethereum from Solana. You can perform actions on all of Cosmos chains from Solana or from Ethereum, from wherever. You can do things from Cosmos, in Cosmos, with your Leap wallet, perform things within Ethereum and Solana. So that's a world that we have never seen before, because now you have, how many of you guys have
more than, you know, 2-3 wallets. You know, you probably have 5, 7, 8 different wallets, right? And that experience is very poor. So by reducing the need to use all these different wallets and without having to bridge over and then do things, you know, just making that whole process one click, that is kind of the ultimate DeFi, the composability that we want to see. Hence, you know, our foundation is called Composable, and our protocol is called Picasso. So we're going down that mission for the next 5-10 years.
What I want is somehow for points to be calculated very easily. Points are the bane of my existence across DeFi integrations, both EtherFi and EigenLayer points. So if someone could solve that, that's a very short-term thing. I think for users onboarding to crypto, I wish that was a lot simpler and more instantaneous. It's very painful.
For me, so I said, like, outside of our team, I'm very hoping that the time and cost to generate ZK proofs gets very, very low, because then we could use those through Hyperlane. Right now, they're still a little bit too expensive, both in calculation cost and computation cost, and in the time that they take, so they're not, like, super feasible. And then internally, we're working on just improving the experience of deploying Hyperlane to automate that. Right now, it's still, you know, you're using our, we've created like a CLI for it. It's still, it's convenient, but I would love for it to get to a one click, and we're hoping to get there over the next 12 months or so.
Perfect. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.